So, Nigel, it's us racing against the world.
As always, Paul, as always.
Gentlemen, start your engines.
Hello and welcome to Ascot, Berkshire, in the heart of the English countryside for round five of the Red Bull Air Race World Championship 2015. The UK's leading thoroughbred horse race course hosts the world's fastest motorsport for the second successive year. And if 2015 is anything close to the event of 12 months ago, this weekend will be the most thrilling, closely fought and critical stop of the season so far, with Britain's air race fans expecting nothing more than the home pilot 1-2 we all enjoyed this time last year. This is the calendar of the 2015 Red Bull Air Race World Championship. We kick-started in Abu Dhabi back in February, and we will wrap it up in Las Vegas in mid-October after eight stops around the world. And this is the story of the season so far. Round one in the UAE going to bottom, as did round two in Chiba, Japan. The first time ever the air race raced in front of a Japanese crowd. But Bonhomme's great rival Hanisar came back into the championship with a brilliant win in Rovinj in Croatia. The last round of the tour, we were flying over the River Danube in Budapest, and win number two for Hanisar. So these are the standings after round four of eight. Bonhomme 5 points clear of Hanisar. The Aussie is in third position, also on 29 points, but Ark holds on to second spot by virtue of those two wins. And here at Ascot, down at the race airport, the atmosphere is electric. The defending champ, Nigel Lamb, must get his season back on track here today. The star find of the season, Martin Schonka, two podium performances. Bessenyay of Hungary, his best ever result of the season so far in qualifying yesterday. The ever-consistent Aussie, Matt Hall. And Hanisar, who it's fair to say has had a disastrous start to the competition here in Ascot with a complete mental block in his qualifying run. But the hot favourite and the home hero, Paul Bonhomme, has looked brilliant, winning qualifying in great style and setting the track record at 1:06.023. It looks to be a battle against Bonhomme and Matt Hall. Nigel Lamb really does need to find a good result here to keep his championship defence hopes alive. 40,000 spectators over the weekend here in Ascot continues to set the records. The atmosphere is electric. Let's introduce our race expert, two times world champion Mike Mangold, who's been out there this morning flying this unique racetrack. Mike, welcome.
The static start is what sets this race different from any other on the series. The pilots have to accelerate quickly to race speed before they pull up for the maneuver in gate number two. As we see here in the graphic, he's out of three going into the chicane. It's a right, left, right turn, rather standard for the pilots now, but then it's our ever important gate five. You're blind as you go over the trees into gate six. You have to line up in the fairway, avoid the trees, get your speed up, and now reverse direction to find the inbound portion of the course. Over G potential here, yes. Finding your next gate, of course, this is what's difficult. Back through gate seven, a rather tricky setup into the chicane for the left-right turn the second time. And then there's gate nine. If the winds pick up, this one can be troublesome. We've seen penalties. We've got the oak tree to avoid. The last final turn out of 10 is back to the finish. It's a straight shot if you line up properly. Boy, everything you can do to get as much speed out of this airplane, that's what's going to find a winner here.
Up in the race tower, head judge Jim DiMatteo and race director, of course, that's Steve Jones, a British pilot, a former race pilot himself, but today he is the director of today's competition. With 40,000 spectators over the weekend, all hoping for a British success on home soil. A spectacular venue, an iconic grandstand, and also some of the side acts have had the crowds on their feet, including Danny McGaskill, one of the many Red Bull stars here in action as part of the build-up to this fifth race of eight on the 2015 Red Bull Air Race World Championship. the best of the weather so far this week. The wind is something that Mike has already pointed out we must watch very carefully indeed. But the word from the pilots, these are perfect race conditions. The round of 14 is a straight knockout round. Doldra will go up against Yoshi Maruya. Lavott against Bessenier, and look at some of these massive clashes towards the end of the round of 14. Pete McLeod against Matt Hall, and the world number two up against the world number one to wrap up the round of 14. Hannes Ott goes against Paul Bonham. But it's Germany versus Japan to get the round of 14 underway.
Matthias Dolderer, Germany.
What I think is really special here in Ascot is that we fly over royal ground and we fly between the trees on a super cool location. I love it.
Well, if you take away some of the penalties that Dolder has picked up in training and in qualifying, he is one of the fastest pilots out there. But we all know the key to success is error-free, penalty-free flying here at Ascot in any race of this World Championship. This is what's so unique about Ascot, one of a kind on the tour, the standing start right down the steeplechase straight, trying to accelerate that plane as quick as they can. But one of the most intriguing factors, Mike, is that their race speed is some 50 knots slower than we're used to in normal competitions.
21 Dolder, smoke on.
Off their normal routine. We've seen problems with Hannes Hart, the Demons are even chasing Matthias Dolder with his roll rates. As he goes through gate one, he's got a good start speed, 150, rather low. As he goes into two, he's taking a cut at that left turn angle. You see him make an oblique turn here to come back to gate three. Aircraft still not up to the full race speed. He will be as he comes through gate three into the chicane, some 200 knots indicated speed, 85 meters per second as he goes left, right, left through there. Now, this is gate number six. He's going to have to line up precisely on the trees to find his line down the fairway into gate seven. Matthias flying very clean. This is what he needs to do. Show the wings level to get himself through the gate so he doesn't incur a penalty for incorrect level. So I'm seeing some longer, wider lines, but it's a clean run. Yes. This is what Matthias needs to do to perhaps beat Yoshimura. As he comes around here, this is our gate number 10, the last of the hard G turns. Clean so far for Matthias as he's going to line up here for gate 11, and then it's a sprint to the finish. All he's got to do is keep it level, and he's going to have a good time to set the standard.
Doldra is just looking to put the pressure on Maruya, and that's an impressive performance.
Number 21 Doldra, 1 minute 8.844 seconds, no penalties. Currently first place in heat one.
Now, importantly for Doldra, that's a clean run, penalty-free, Mike, and that's what's been dogging the German throughout this week.
It has been the roll rate. He has increased the roll rate on that aircraft. He's been unable to control himself and it coming out of the gates, but what I saw here was composure, a man that knows what he had to do. There's room for improvement, but he did what he needed to do.
Competition, Maruya's up next.
Yoshihide Maruya, Japan.
Okay, Ascot here is a very good scenery. Then there is a lot of trees and golf course, so it's lots of fun to fly for the pilot.
Now, Yoshi Maruya has got to better the time of Dolger. The fastest will go through, and whoever is the quicker, the losing pilot, will hope that he's the fastest qualifier. Seven will go through, and the fastest loser will make up the round of eight, the second part of the competition. But the pressure is on these pilots from the moment that they start competition on race day. Some good Japanese support amongst the 20,000-plus fans out there today. Yoshi Maruya, a PB of six so far this season in the opener in Abu Dhabi. But Mike, it's fair to say we've seen glimpses of brilliance from the Japanese pilot. He's just yet to put it all together on race day.
Right, both these guys, Matthias and Yoshi, are hot and cold. If they're hot, boy, they're fast. If they're cold, they can be terrible. Matthias did a fair run. Yoshi's looking good. He's one of the more vocal pilots. You'll hear him grunt and groan and even talk to himself if we tune into his cockpit radio. There it is right there. Yoshi just grunting as he comes through more to get himself going into the chicane, nice and level, a minimal flight control input. This is fast. He's right on his line as he goes through gate number five.
Mike, we hear this grunting and groaning. It's to help deal with the G-force, and no other sport, no other motorsport puts this amount of G on their athletes, their pilots, or their competitors. Green light for Yoshi Maruya.
You see him roll out and bank in. This is going to cost him a little bit. He was a little indecisive there in that turn, and that's a few tenths of a second. A little high going into the chicane. So he's off a little bit on his perfect line. We're going to see if he can make it up here in the last portion of the course. This final turn from gate 10 will make the big difference. He's still in the green.
Green light it is for Yoshi Maruya of Japan, coming out of Champions Corner into the straight now. Full throttle all the way to the Breitling start-finish gate. Maruya looking to put Doldra out of the competition, and it's good news for Yoshi Maruya.
1 minute, 7.623 seconds, no penalties. You are the winner of Heat 1. Hold three, please. Call grid. Matthias just touching down.
You can see the emotion for yourself from the cockpit cam. Maruya is delighted to have put Doldra out of the competition.
I think the most of this grunting and groaning is not necessarily for the G, but he's trying to encourage himself to get going. He's like trying to get the horse to giddy up. Maybe some of this Ascot horse racing is worn off. But Yoshi's doing whatever it takes to keep himself composed and get through it. We saw one little glimpse of a mistake here in his big turn from gate 6 to 7. He literally rolled out of the turn and came back in. So there's spots where Yoshi can pick up some time as he moves on to the round of 8.
Well, we go on to our next heat. Francois Levaught, rookie to the 2015 Masterclass, up against the veteran and the many who call Peter Bessenier the godfather of the sport. But it's the rookie to go first, the Frenchman Levaught.
France. My goal here is to be very clean from the takeoff to the landing, because the layout, the track, everything is very technical.
Levaught racing in Ascot for the first time in his career, a former French Air Force fighter pilot and a world and European unlimited aerobatic champion. There's no question in years to come Levaught will be a force to be reckoned with, but for now, Mike, he's just learning the ropes of this game, because it's not easy out there at all.
He's finding out what teamwork is. It's not just the pilot. He talks about flying clean, which is penalty-free, but you've got to have a fast aircraft. Francois elected to climb high, dive into gate one. Here's where the timing starts. Now he goes to gate two. He's got to make this high G turn without stalling the airplane. He stays very level. Another one of our animated pilots, and he really does run for the G, as you hear the in-cockpit audio there from Francois. Through gate number three, now into the chicane, minimal G, but everything's happening quick at 85 meters per second. As he comes around here to gate number five, precise lineup through these trees to be on the proper position for gate six in amongst the trees.
Let's listen to Levaught through horseshoe turn.
So you heard it. That was, and it's real quick. These G's happen quick, Nick. They're up to 10 G's in less than a half a second, and it could be gone that quick also.
Smoke violation for Francois Levaught. That's 1 second added to his time. Insufficient smoke is the technical term.
You can see the smoke. It's just not thick enough. And what the smoke does, it actually detracts from the performance of the airplane. So they want all pilots to have about the same amount of smoke. Here you see almost nil. And this is why the 1 second penalty does not help Francois' effort. And another penalty for incorrect level in that far gate 10 in the Champions Corner.
So 3 seconds of penalty, disappointment to the French pilot.
1 minute, 13.511 seconds, 3 seconds penalty, insufficient smoke, and incorrect level gate 10, but currently first place, heat two. Hold three, please. Call grid.
You can see it. One of our classic mistakes is that the pilot thinks start the roll, and boy, these airplanes respond so quickly. The fuselage reference point, which is the pilot's helmet, must pass between the two line or between the gates before they can roll the aircraft. They give them up to 10 degrees of bank before they call the penalty, but these aircraft roll so fast, the pilot's thinking ahead, maybe a little bit too far ahead, is why they incur that penalty.
Well, of course, the times are just up against your opponent in these heats. And he's really given Peter Bessenier, who you can see just at the top of your screens, a golden opportunity here.
Peter Bessenier, Hungary. I'm very happy to be back in Ascot, because it's a super track. It's very challenging to fly between the trees, and the static display, it's very unique.
So Peter Bessenier, who actually flew one of his best qualifying rounds of the season so far 24 hours ago, and he flew into fourth position, 107 spot 443. And a lot of people are accrediting this newfound confidence and form from Bessenier to this brand new Edge 540 version 3, Mike. Every possible modification you can get, he's put on this plane, and it seems to be working.
Yeah, it sure does. It's the latest and the greatest from the Zifco Aeronautics Corporation. They are the ones that build it. Peter's got some modification. And as he starts here, he's trying to get accelerated. We've seen 150 knots through gate number one. Let's see what the graphic shows us. About 149. So good speed from Peter as he goes into gate two. He too is going to go oblique or horizontal as he reverses direction to come into gate number three. Peter's got good smoke. You can see how strong it is, so he will not get that penalty. Flying really nice and clean as he goes through the chicane. Peter has to watch. Sometimes he likes to fly low. He comes here into gate number six. As he goes over the trees, I should say, into gate six, rather wide line into six. But let's see, he's still in the green, of course, against the penalty Francois Lavotte. Now, as he comes back to seven, it's the setup into the chicane.
Well, I think he's using his experience and using that experience wisely here, Mike. Let's not forget he's won 8 times, 22 times on the podium, one of the innovators of the air race. He knows he's got 3 seconds advantage. The time that he puts down here bears no significance whatsoever to the round of 8 or the final 4. He's just got to put Lavotte out of the competition, and this is a very smooth, clean, tactical performance, I would say, from Peter Bessenier, who puts Hungary into the final 8 with a great performance.
Number 91, Bessenier, 1 minute 8.919 seconds, no penalties. And you are the winner of Heat 2. Hold 3, please. Call grid. Francois has just landed.
All right, so we'll take a look here at Peter's run. Like you say, he's actually, the format's helping Peter here. He didn't have to push himself too hard. Didn't take much to beat Francois. But Peter's still getting to know this new aircraft. He said those very distinctive wing tips or winglets now, because they curve up and they come to a point. A lot of the pilots feeling this aerodynamic shape moves that wingtip vortice off the wing, decreasing drag, increasing the aileron effectiveness.
Well, let's move on to our next heat. This is the United States of America going up against France. And Michael Goulian will be the next man to fly. And he's up against Nicolas Ivanov, the French pilot, currently lying 9th in the championship standings. But again, Michael Goulian, I have to say, has looked pretty impressive in training.
1 or 2 minutes.
Well, already Yoshi Maruya and Peter Bessenier are confirmed to go through to the next round. Of course, we only have one runway. As well as planes taking off, there are planes coming back down on the steeplechase part of the race course here. We're not actually allowed on the flat race course.
Right, that, sequencing
that
here.
That really is a sacred ground.
As you see Peter land there, you know, we have the sequence of pilots on and off, and we want to make sure that's done safely. And I must say that with the standing start, it puts the pilots off their normal routine.
Let's take a look at some of the key rules and regulations that make the Red Bull Air Race the world's fastest motorsport.
Unfortunately, there have to be some rules.
The rule starts right at the beginning, entry speed. For various reasons, firstly to comply with the laws of different countries, but also to make it safe. And we have an entry speed limit, 200 knots, 370 kilometers per hour, 230 miles an hour. That's the fastest the pilot is allowed to fly through the start gate.
Over the speed of 200 knots on the entry, pushing too hard.
And knock it off, the excessive start speed.
Whilst the race pilot is in the track, his aircraft must have smoke.
No smoke! Out of harness.
Oh, he's just put it on, but I think he'll take the penalty.
The next penalty is passing through an air gate. The rules say you must be in the top 40% of the gate.
What you have to do is not be below this, the band here, because that's too low, you'll be disqualified. and if you are above, you will get a 2-second penalty.
You have to be wings level once you go through those pylons. So exactly in between those pylons, you have to be wings level. Then you can start to turn again.
Passing through a gate, your wings must be level, but you're allowed a 10 degree left or 10 degree right tolerance on that. So if you're within 10 degrees of wings level, passing through a gate, that's no penalty.
What you really, really do not want to do is hit a pylon, because a pylon hit is another penalty.
A new rule is 3 seconds now for a gate hit. If you hit another gate, it's another 3 seconds.
A third pylon hit is deemed to be too many, and that's did not finish. Your race is over.
Oh, it's gone! Pete McLeod!
There are 4 things that could result in disqualification. Firstly, crowd line, flying too close to the crowd line. It's a safety issue, so if the pilot flies too close to the spectators, disqualification.
We had a outside the crowd line box for after gate 4.
Secondly, dangerous flying. If the race director sees any flying that he judges to be dangerous or unsteady, again, grounds for disqualification.
We need to be keeping the chief judge happy in terms of the way we fly. They don't want to see anything erratic in the track. We can't be descending in gates because that's potentially dangerous.
Third thing, over G, pulling too much G. Again, a safety thing, so that could result in disqualification.
Knock it off, knock it off, knock it off. We have a over G 10.8.
Fourth and final thing, underweight. The aircraft is deemed to be under its minimum race weight. Again, disqualification.
So the key facts to our rules and regulations as we continue with the round of 14. United States of America up against France, Goulian up against Ivanov. This one will be very closely contested.
Michael Goulian, United States.
I think for all the pilots and me included, Ascot is our favorite place. It's tight, it's low to the ground, it's around the trees. You get a feeling of speed and we just love to be here.
One of the most personable pilots on the tour with a new team and a new plane for 2015, Michael Goulian. And that new team including Pablo Branco, Dax Wanless, his technician in the center of screen there, and Stephen Hall, his race tactician. They've been coming close, this American team, Mike, and a lot of people feel that it could all come together here in Ascot. He said it himself, he loves to race here, and the team seem to have the plane in the setup that he wants.
They sure do. They got the machine going fast, and Michael there, you saw him lift his tailwheel before he actually released his brakes. A very clever tactic. And now smoke is on as he heads into gate 1. We'll look at the graphic for his start speed. He has a little heavier wing than most, 147, so not one of the fastest ones, but the wing on this aircraft has got more cord length, has got more wetted area, hence this is one of the tightest turns that we see here as Michael comes back into gate number 3. Now he's up to full race speed. Michael just has to keep his composure. He's got a fast airplane. This is looking very nice with Michael Goulian. Hard around in here to gate number 5. Now over the trees to find his spot down the golf fairway. This looks very, very wide, I must say. So he's got a lot of distance before the gate. This is extra time. Nice tight turn with that aircraft as Michael comes back to gate 7. He's going to set the mark for Nicholas to beat, but I'm seeing some wider lines out of Michael. Yeah, safer, but it's going to cost him in time.
He needs to fly lower than 1.08 and to improve his times in qualifying and in training here. But also, he's looking to try and put a little bit of pressure on Ivanov. Oh, that looked a little bit late.
Yep, we'll see what the judges say, but let's see if he's clean here through gate number 11 into the finish. So Michael, maybe a little bit too relaxed, maybe off his timing, off his line. It's going to be a...
Number 99, Goulian, 1 minute 8.721 seconds, no penalties. Currently first place in Heat 3. Hold 3, please, call grid.
Well, back in the Team Goolian race hangar, they seem pleased enough with that time, but I think Ivanov may be motivated to better that, Mike, surely.
You can see the tree with the red mark in it, and a long straight line before gate six. So Michael flying, I believe, a little bit wider track line than he needs to. This costs, of course, more time, more distance. Is he too cautious here in the round of 14? We'll find out, but airplane looks like it's going fast. It's flying rather smooth. This may be a line or a tactic error. And then, of course, we had a little slip up in gate 10. Looks like he got himself either late rolled out, so no penalty. I think he's lucky there.
Team Hamilton and Ivanov, the French pilot, up next.
Nicolas Ivanov, France. I'm really focused on the landing because you have so many people looking at you during the landing. So I will do my best for landing.
Well, he's always got time to put a smile on everybody's face, but believe you me, when he gets into that cockpit, this man is one of the fighters for podium positions. Many of you may remember Nicolas Ivanov, the French pilot, coming third here last year, and it was that third position that kick-started two wins on the second half of the tour in 2014 for Ivanov.
Tail up, maximum acceleration is what Nicholas is all about. He's going to go a little bit to the left, come back right for a better line through gate number one where the timing starts. His speed looks like 145, about the same as Michael's. Now watch Nicholas, not so wide as he goes through two. He's making a flat turn, looks pretty good, not quite as tight as the Goolian turn. As he comes back through three, we'll get our first glimpse of how the sector times are doing. But Nicholas certainly capable of, I think, beating that time that Goolian put down. Nice straight line through the chicane. Let's see how wide Nicholas goes from gate 5 to 6. He takes more of a direct line as he goes over the tree. This could be to his benefit. As Nicholas dives down in the fairway, we'll get our next split time, and there it is.
Nice line out of horseshoe turn, coming back down now, the last six gates to be taken in. Ivanov not quite getting the speed and energy in the first pass, but as he comes back now through the chicane and towards the grandstand, this is looking very good for Ivanov. Just climbs a little high as he goes over the oak tree and into Champions Corner for the last time.
Very nice flying out of Nicholas. Spot on there, little trouble in the chicane, but he recovered. Now he's going back through 11. In the green by a second. I'm going to say if he holds it true, he should move on. Nicholas is just going to keep the airplane unloaded, accelerating to the finish.
Ivanov looks to put the American Goolian out and does just that.
27, Ivanov, 1 minute 7.967 seconds, no penalties. You are the winner of Heat 3. Hold 3, please, call grid.
Well, Goolian is the fastest loser at this point in the competition, but Ivanov secured a place in the round of eight.
Nicholas flying very nice lines out there. I think Michael's airplane capable of tighter. Let's watch here as they go through our gate number 10 out there, and it's a six, rather. It's the right turn. You see Nicholas actually stays lower as he comes in. There we go. Tighter line into gate six, so he gets out of the turn quicker. Look at the turn out of the Goolian airplane inside of the version two that Nicholas is flying, but Nicholas, by virtue of keeping a little bit more speed on, stays out in front of Mike.
So it's a waiting game now for Pilot 99 at Mikey Goolian, beaten by Ivanov in heat three, but he's currently in the fastest loser position. Let's move on to the next heat, Spain versus the Czech Republic. Velarde up against Martin Žonka. Velarde will fly first.
Juan Velarde, Spain.
Here in Ascot, everything is about matching the energy of the plane, so we're starting from speed zero, and we need to fly clean and smooth in order to keep it up.
So the Spanish rookie out of Madrid racing in Ascot for the first time as a master in his career. And he really has a tough task here, Mike, up against Martin Žonka of the Czech Republic. Žonka coming off the back of two podium positions and lying fourth in the championship standings. Velarde can just ask
Velarde,
only
smoke on
to improve his time from qualifying 109 spot 996 and can ask no more.
Right, Juan's going to need some help from Martin in the way of a mistake, but Juan a little different tactic. He climbed up high, he dove into gate one, laid on the smoke. Is this going to help? He needs to do everything he can. Juan's airplane not as fast as the others. As he comes back through gate three, this sets the mark. He's flying very nice into the chicane. It actually slopes downhill, so the pilot must let the aircraft descend. Goes over to gate five. This is a wide turn into five. A little adjustment in the wings. Again, he's wide, I believe, going into six. These things add up. They're a tenth of a second. As he makes his turn there, horseshoe turn. Nice turn, very flat. comes across the trees, lining up for seven, trying to get the proper entry into the chicane. You got to stay a little bit wide because this is 135 degrees a turn. You don't want to get late. He handles it well through the chicane, on to gate number nine into the finish.
Right, competition corner, the last vertical turn maneuver. You can make or break here. Gets those wings level through the gate. Now, hard on the stick. Needs to level it up for the penultimate gate before the Breitling start finish. Here comes Velarde. He'd be delighted to fly faster than 1.09. And you can ask no more. 1.09.003.
1:09.003 seconds, no penalties. Currently first place in heat four.
Lovely shot over Juan's Corbett. Father there, who's been such an influence on Velarde's career as a young pilot, and improving every time he takes the track, Mike.
I was going to say, this is good for Juan. This is almost a full second over his qualifying time as you see him go through the chicane. Nice cadence, he's not late in the turns, so his flying as a driver is spot on. Shot there with an Airbus 380 in the background. Similar colors, similar livery there as the Spanish pilot.
Well, as a rookie to the tour, you can ask no more from Velarde. Every time he takes the track, his times improve. The question now, is that good enough to stop Martin Schonka in his quest for his third successive podium in the 2015 Red Bull Air Race?
Martin Schonka, Czech Republic.
I really like the track here in Ascot because of the static start. It's totally different compared to all the others. And I really like the track between the trees.
Well, there is Team Schonka. Lance Winter on the right of your screens, the technician. He's got this plane, this Edge 540 version 3, flying very nicely indeed. And for me, Schonka is starting to find, discover, understand the key ingredient to success on the Red Bull Air Race World Championship, and that is consistency, Mike. He's starting to look like one of the world's best. Second in Ravine, third last month in Budapest. Can he take his first win here at Ascot, England?
It's possible. Martin goes very low through gate one, but it gives him maximum speed, makes a little check turn, a setup here into two. Hard left, one of our lower or flatter flyers, but Lance Winter got that airplane going very fast as he comes back here through three. I expect to see green right off the bat. Sure we do. Into the chicane, nice cadence. He's a little bit late, but he's flying very straight, which is fast. All right, as he goes through gate number five, he picks his spot, where to go over. Look, he can go left wide again. Look at the straight line before six. A little wider line could be tightened in his next round as he moves through. But nice turn at the horseshoe reversal. Back through seven, slapping the wings rather quickly. He needs to make sure he doesn't incur a penalty so that he beats Juan Velarde. Anyway, as he comes through here, nine, it's one last vertical turn to the finish.
Well, this man was third fastest in qualifying, and he's showing all of those skills here. But what I have to say is most impressive about the former Czech Air Force fighter pilot. Very calm, very cool. All he has to do is beat Velarde. The time will be disregarded as he moves forward to the round of eight, and Schonka moves forward in style.
Number eight, Schonka, 1:07.405 seconds, no penalties. You are the winner of heat four. Hold three, please, Corgrid.
Thank you very much, hold three.
Thank you, turn your transponder on, please.
Lance, very happy. Okay, as we see Martin come around here, what I was going to say is I see a little sloppiness in his flying. He's slapping the wings. He's not being real clean. He's got to be very careful that as he pushes his speed, he doesn't incur the penalty. So I'd like to see him clean it up a little bit, or he may pick up that two-second penalty, which certainly will not help him.
It's a good point that you make, Mike, and let's not forget that the pressure starts to build as we get to the round of eight and final four.
You see how quickly Martin comes out of that gate three into the chicane, and Juan is just trailing him, but his airplane moving forward ever so slightly, it tells you that the Schonka plane is faster than the Velarde plane. And you can see Martin always takes a tighter line into gate number five. So very good graphic there to show the differences in the aircraft and the pilot line.
Let's move on to heat five. First of the British pilots, Nigel Lam, goes up against the second American pilot, Kirby Chambliss. Lam will be the first to fly.
Nigel Lam, Great Britain. There are many challenges for Ascot, the standing start, the trees, the track. But the biggest challenge for the home guys is avoiding too many distractions during race week.
A very good quote and point made there from Nigel Lamb. It has been an incredibly busy week for both Nigel and for Paul Bonham. They need to put the outside pressures behind them and now focus at the job in hand. Lamb needs a good result here today, Mike.
Nigel elected to climb high and dive into one, about a 142 start speed. He goes right, left, into gate two, again, very flat. Nice tight turn out of Nigel with those winglets on that Breitling MXR. He comes back through three. I suspect it's going to be very close when we see the sector time into the chicane. Nice for Nigel. A little descent going there. He's got a tight turn going into five. Let's see how he does over the trees if he flies a more direct line. Looking good. Nigel right down in, and he's high, but just enough to get in the gate as he comes back at the horseshoe turn, back to gate seven. Nigel flying, I think, maybe just a little cautious here. Got to watch his altitude. Very wide into the chicane. There's your penalty. I said too high. Nigel, as he comes into gate number nine, needs to lay down a good time if he's going to advance.
Oh, this is a big, big nightmare for Nigel Lamb here. He's coming out of Champions Corner. He's already picked up 2 seconds of penalty for incorrect passing of gate five and just taking it a little too easy, I'd say, conservative with his outbound pass. Not a good time for Nigel Lamb.
Number nine, Lamb, 1 minute, 10.047 seconds. 2 seconds penalty, too high, gate five, but currently first place in heat five. Hold three, please. Call grid.
Well, the cockpit cam tells the story. Lamb is furious with himself.
Yeah, there you can see it on a replay. He's just out the top. Again, it's the helmet, not the landing gear, that must be below the top of the pylons. Sometimes what happens is the pilots stay high for better visibility, maybe a little tactic here, but you've got to make sure you're in these zones to get credit at gate passage. And uncharacteristic, but certainly one of the rules. Nigel knows this, so a costly error. But let's see. Let's see what Kirby does, because he still has to fly a good run if he wants to beat Nigel.
Well, we spotted it here on our monitors in the commentary box. You can guarantee the head judge, Jim DiMatteo, has spotted it with a lovely shot from our helicopter of Heathrow Airport. Now here's a golden opportunity for Kirby.
Kirby Chambliss, United States.
You know, Ascot, I mean, it's a little bit unique. We're going to be doing a stand and start here. We're probably not going to get a lot of training out of them track because of the weather. So we'll just see how it goes.
Here is the Texan, Kirby Chambliss, 2006 world champion. 8 wins, 25 podiums. One of the most exciting, but often the most aggressive pilots out there, Mike.
And Nigel's given him an opening. You don't do this with Kirby. If Kirby saw it, he knows it, so he's going to take advantage. He accelerates with the tailwheel up, maximum acceleration. Kirby's going to elect to go left. You got to watch that light post there, Kirby.
Smoke on.
And he's coming back right, trying to get a better line into gate number two. His start speed, 143, about average today. As he dips down, he goes right and then left for a hard left turn. Kirby, one of the high G pullers. He's got to be careful. Of course, he's not up to race speed. But let's see what his sector time looks like back through gate three. A little wide coming into three. But oh my gosh, again, that 2 second penalty. Kirby still 25 hundredths of a second ahead had Nigel not incurred it. As Kirby goes through five, over the trees, really close. He's got a long line before six, and he's high too. But he's in the zone as he comes back for six into seven. He's got to be, you know, finding the proper line here. I'm wondering why these guys are flying so high back there, but Kirby dips down low as he comes into the chicane for the final time.
Well, there's a small shift in the wind, but it's not much at all, only around about 3.6 knots. Here comes Kirby Chambliss, last vertical turn maneuver over the oak tree, through Champions Corner, pull back hard on the stick, breathe, absorb, try and work with the G, not against it. It is the pilot's enemy, the G-force in the cockpit. Now Kirby, full throttle, that looked a little high on the penultimate gate for Kirby, but so far so good. It's under review.
Chambliss, 1 minute, 10.590 seconds. That's a 2 seconds penalty, flying too high, gate 11, and that's second place in heat five. Hold three, please.
He's done all the work, Mike. Well, he was there. The American was through.
What happens when you roll out, you got all this G on the airplane, you got all this lift created. When he rolls out, that wing just pops the airplane up. If you're not quick enough to unload and react to it, you're going to jump up a meter or two. And it's just, it's sloppy flying. I suspect, though, there's something in the visuals out there today where the pilots are a little bit unsure of their elevation, their clearance from these obstacles, so they're erring on the safe side, the high side. Of course, the high side will get you a penalty. So we'll watch as the day unfolds, but these are uncharacteristic penalties that I'm seeing out of these professional pilots.
Well, it's a nightmare for Kirby Chambliss. It's great news for the British fans, because just when we thought Nigel Lamb was out of the competition, Kirby Chambliss gets a two-second penalty, and Lamb is in the round of eight and goes forward through to the next round. There are still two heats to go, and the two hottest heats of the round of 14. Pete McLeod goes up against Matt Hall, and the big one, Hannes Arc, goes up against Paul Bonham in the last duel of the round of 14. What a lucky escape for Nigel Lamb. He will be counting his lucky stars when he gets out of the cockpit of that MXSR race plane, because he thought he'd thrown it away, only to see the same error from Kirby. Here's the information. Vicky Griffiths, his team coordinator, Nigel Huxtable, his technician, they're right there to give all of the information, yeah. Mike.
You're right. Lucky for Nigel Lamb, but a very costly and uncharacteristic mistake for Kirby Chambliss. Kirby's a veteran of this thing. We've been racing since 2004. I really find it hard to believe, but this is how precise you have to fly as a driver out there. We're talking centimeters, 30 centimeters away from the edge of the gate. He's 50 centimeters out the top. So they're capable of doing it. You've got to stay focused. You've got to pay attention. You've got to control the variables out here to be a winner.
This is the format of the round of 14. It's a knockout competition. It'll be the same in the round of eight as well, when we'll whittle them down just to four. And then the last four will go against the clock. Now, still good news for the United States of America. Chambliss may be out of the competition, but the USA still has one pilot to cheer for. Mikey Goolian holds on to the fastest loser spot. He's with Jonathan Ledyard.
Mike, how tense is this now? You just got to stand and wait and hope.
Yeah, it's a hard place to be. I thought I did a really great run. We went out with a plan. I did that plan great. I think probably a little too wide. I was a little too tight yesterday going into the far gate on the golf course. I probably brought it a little too wide. That was probably where a little bit of the time went away. But other than that, we just have to hope and see, and we're just going to go for it in the round of eight. So we're hoping we're going to be there.
So you just sit now, and do you analyze the next pairings going, well, he can do that, and he can do that, yeah, and I might do this, and so on?
Yeah, absolutely. You know, the Paul and Hannes thing, maybe one of those guys will make a mistake. Same thing with Matt and Pete, and then you just got to see where you sit.
Oh, fingers crossed.
You got it. Thanks.
Well, the American Air Race fans certainly have their fingers crossed, because Chambliss is out and Goolian holds on to the fastest loser position. There are two heats left to go. Heat six, Pete McLeod, lying fifth in the World Championship standings, goes up against Matt Hall, who lies third in the Championship standings. And of course, we save the best till last due to unfortunate circumstances in the qualifying, where Hannes Arc just blew it completely. The slowest goes up against the fastest from qualifying. Therefore, in Heat 7, the last of this session, the world number one goes up against the world number two. Hannes Arc flies first. He goes up against Paul Bonham. All kinds of problems yesterday, Mike. They've got to get in the zone to put this right today.
I hate to say it, but I'm seeing Hannes and Team Arc trying to start the airplane now. They had starting problems yesterday, engine problems that may have carried over till today. There's just, like I said, so many variables you got to control out here, and it can get cumbersome. The pilot alone can't do it. That's why he needs a team.
Well, we'll hope and keep our fingers crossed that Hannes Arc can get that engine started. For those of you that weren't with us through qualifying yesterday, Hannes Arc had a bit of a mental block out himself pulling. He decided himself to pull a safety climb out, but then his second run of qualifying, Mike, failed to get that engine started, and he ended the day 14th, last of all.
Right. I hope it doesn't plague him today, but we'll focus on this next matchup.
That's right. Now, the next matchup will be Heat 6. Pete McLeod of Canada will go up against Matt Hall of Australia. Well, every possible viewpoint has been taken as we get down to the business end of the round of 14. These are the two hot heats to decide who goes through to the round of 8. Canada up against Australia, and it's the youngest pilot, Pete McLeod, who goes first.
Pete McLeod, Canada.
I think the challenge for Ascot is going to be similar to every race, and that's to fly fast but clean and consistent. The competition's going to be tight, and we can't afford any mistakes.
So Pete McLeod coming off the back of a fourth position in the last round of the Red Bull Air Race World Championship. Let's not forget he was on the podium at the season opener in Abu Dhabi. The Garmin team all patiently waiting to see if Pete McLeod
can put
the pressure on Matt Hall. Mike, that's got to be the tactic for the Canadian. Put down a fast time and try and force the errors from his Australian counterpart. So
Pete's trying to go to the left, come back to the right before gate one, much like Kirby did. He had a good start speed. He's coming back around here. This is a nice line out of Peter as he goes through gate number three. He's going to make a direct entry. He's rather low as he goes in the chicane, but he's in the red zone. He goes through our chicane gate number four, wide here into five a little bit. Let's watch him over the trees. He picks his place again down in the fairway here. He's going to go low, which we've seen pilots be high before, as he comes out of the trees, gate six, back to seven. All right. Gate hit. You can see.
Gate five. He's clipped it. Gate five means 3 seconds of penalty for the pylon hit. Oh, and it's looking like a nightmare for Pete McLeod and a wonderful opportunity for Matt Hall to go through to the next round.
He needs to finish the run. You never know what can happen out here. So as he comes back around from gate 10, he's going to go to the finish through 11 and put down some type of time so that he can perhaps move forward if, in fact, Matt Hall has trouble.
What a disappointment for the Canadian Pete McLeod.
84 McLeod, 1 minute 11.019 seconds, 3 second penalty, gate hit six. And but currently first place in heat six. So hold three, please, call grid.
What I can only suspect, Nick, is there's something going on out there around gate six. I'm going to speculate it may be turbulence because the pilots are flying high. If they come over the trees and you get a bump, it gets your attention. Pete went down there lower than the two previous pilots, and, oh, you can just see he's so close. We're talking 20 centimeters, and it just gets the right wingtip on there. So is it the visuals? Is it turbulence? This gate is posing a problem for these pilots, and we're seeing some fly high and get the penalty. We're seeing others hit the gate here.
But, Mike, let's put it into perspective here. Pete McLeod must be coming into that gate, what, at around about 400 kilometers per hour,
yes,
around about 250 mph, and
yep,
you're telling me 10, 15 centimeters in it. It's an incredibly fine line.
That's what I'm saying. That's the skill set that the pilots that possess out here to get that close at that speed to make these decisions. It takes a full second for you to see something, transmit it to your hand, and make the airplane doing it. So you've got to look ahead over 100 meters and know where the airplane's going to be 100 meters away. And he was 30 centimeters off, 20 centimeters off on this one. But what I'm saying is something is throwing him off back there. Visuals, turbulence, wind. I don't see any wind. The sun, you know, we see some bright spots. We see some dark spots out here. Your depth perception, how you judge distances, is what makes or breaks a good pilot.
Well, there is no question of a doubt when our pilots fly over the Royal Ascot Golf Club. Founded in 1887, 128 years of age. It may be one of the oldest and most beautiful golf courses in the country. It's posing problems for the world's fastest motorsport and the top air race pilots in the world.
Right.
Right, let's catch up. Maybe Nigel Lamb and Jonathan Ledyard can cast a little more light on that part of the track for us, because Jonathan is with Nigel at the race airport.
So, Nigel, how do you look back at that particular performance? Your face says a lot.
Lucky. Unbelievable. I knew I was a bit high there, but just so focused on trying to fix the things that weren't right yesterday, which I think I fixed some of them. But, I mean, to ride high in an easy gate, it's pathetic, really.
But you're through, and the time was good.
Yeah,
108.
The time was okay. It's about my quickest. I would have wanted a quicker raw time than that in these conditions. I mean, it's not good enough to win, but what I've got to do now is creep up a bit, because I think I fixed some stuff from yesterday and there's more to fix, so hopefully we can find that.
Good luck, Mr. Fixit.
But thanks for the gods smiling on me, and thank you, Kirby. I mean, I'm lucky. Didn't deserve it, really.
Well, a little bit of lady luck often shines on those who deserve it. And Nigel Lam, very humble in moving forward to the next round, but a win's a win. Let's see what Matt Hall has to say.
Matt Hall, Australia.
Ascot, it's a great racetrack, over land, down fairways at a golf course, over and around trees. Really looking forward to it in front of a big crowd.
And a lot of Australian support for Matt Hall. Three podium performances from four races so far this season. Looked very good in training, Mike. I have to say, second fastest in qualifying. One of only two pilots to fly 1.06. He can coast a little out there to go through to the next round, surely.
95 Hall, smoke on.
All right, as Matt climbs high, he's going to just descend into this. Sure, Matt is one of the fastest here lately. He just needs to follow through here and have a good run, which should be relatively easy if he doesn't make a mistake. As he goes into this gate number two, our first IG turn, he comes back to three, accelerating at race speed. You're going to see probably green as he goes through here at a sector time into the chicane. This is just a nice, easy cadence. And now here's our trouble area coming out. As he goes into five, let's see, he's taking a wide line, which is smart, and he's going a little bit left and then back right as he comes down into gate six. He comes up, it looks clean, they're still standing. Nice tight turn back to seven. Ever important, out of seven to line up into the chicane. You do need to stay a little wide to get a straight shot into the chicane. Matt doing a really nice job. Textbook flying out of Matt Hall. Through our gate number nine, over the oak tree, set up into gate number 10. Another high G turn. Watch it, you don't over G. Looks like he's in within limits. Back through gate 11, a sprint to the finish.
Mission accomplished for Matt Hall, having a brilliant season in 2015, but he's yet to win one, but he's well on his way here in Ascot, England.
Number 95 Hall, 1:06.833, no penalties. You are the winner of heat six. Hole three, call grid.
Thanks, mate. Good job inside.
Wow, that was fast.
That was incredibly fast. Fastest flight of the day so far. Not quite as quick as the track record set by Paul Bonham, who's flying in the seventh and final heat. But I have to say, Matt Hall's confidence continues to grow. I'm not sure he'll make the same mistake that he made in the last round in Budapest when he took his eye off the ball.
I hope not, but I think that was a great run that he just laid down here. Given the conditions, we saw areas where he can actually take some time off, you know, as he makes and moves on to the next round. But I think very good run out of Matt Hall.
So this is the big one, the seventh and final heat of the round of 14. The world ranked number two, Hannes Ark, goes up against the world ranked number one, Paul Bonham. Nobody wanted this clash so early on, but that's the way the format works.
Austria.
So the challenge in Ascot is to perform like the last two races, not get lost in the tree and to turn on my smoke.
Well, he's got a sense of humour. You've got to give him that, Hannes Ark. That's exactly what he did. Got lost in the trees and has had problems with the smoke. UBFS Racing waiting patiently in the hangar. Can Hannes Ark pick it up here and raise his game? The winner of the last two rounds of the Red Bull Air Race World Championship in great style. But, Mike, he really struggled here yesterday.
Hannes has got to stay focused. If it means be jovial, perhaps, but this guy needs to get down to work. He is a true professional racer, and he's got to watch every little detail. Here he's got his right wingtip too close to the fence. Hannes needs to play everything safe and smart, and then, of course, once he get in the air, he needs to just do what he does best, which is go fast. So Hannes is getting lined up here. He's going to run that engine up. He knows he's got to lay down a good run to beat Paul Bonham.
And he knows that if he puts down a very fast time, that could upset the current world championship leader's psyche and maybe just put him under a little bit of extra pressure. Here comes Hannes Ark in heat seven. This is the hot one that everybody's on the edge of their seats waiting and watching. Confidence really not there for Hannes Ark, but he has this magical ability to raise his game when all the pressure is on, and he needs that skill right here, right now.
He took a straight line with a little bit of a descent into number two. This is for maximum acceleration. It looks like it's paying off. I'm seeing some very precise flying. Ooh, little bit incomplete rollout, if you will, on gate number three. The wings have to be level within 10 degrees. Very tight line into five where he had problems yesterday. Over the trees, he's wide into gate six. He's high. Is he going to get down as he comes back up? Through gate six, over to seven. Hannes a little bit off his line. High again, over bank. High through number seven, into the chicane. All right, this is looking good. He's got a tight line. He's a little bit late in the turns as he comes to nine. Is it okay? Yes.
Champions corner. Up he goes. Vertical turn maneuver number three. He's on his way home. This is the fastest, cleanest run we've seen from the former world champion all week long. But it's under review from the race tower. There could be a penalty for Hannes Ark as he heads for home and stops the clock with a scintillating time.
Number 22, Ark, 1 minute 6.178 seconds, no penalties. Currently first place.
Oh my, talk about having us on the edge of our seats. Fastest time anybody's flown all day long, from a DNF to a 106.178. A remarkable performance from Hannes Ark, and throws the gauntlet down to bottom.
Course record out of Hannes Ark, but like I say, he's on the edge, and this is the difference. On the edge on the good side, in order to be a winner out here, especially against Paul Bottom, you got to push your limits. Hannes did exactly that, but look at him, just high. Look at the roll starting. He's within the 10 degrees. I'll tell you, this is about as close as to the limit that I would want to fly.
But look at the sigh of relief on Ark's face. Here's Paul Bonhomme.
Paul Bonhomme, Greg Bresson.
The challenge of Ascot is the distraction management. We've got lots of friends and family here. Trying to keep that in check and just concentrate on the flying is the real battle, but it's going to be fun.
Wise words from the current World Championship leader, Paul Bonhomme. Hannes Ark, keep calm. From Nigel Warren, keep calm, fly like Bonhomme is the message from the team Bonhomme hangar, and Paul needs to do just that. This is the most successful air race pilot of all. 17 wins, 42 podiums, the winner here last year. But he said it himself, Mike, the pressure is on. And I have to say, there's 20,000 fans below us and around us, and it feels and sounds like they're all cheering for Bonhomme right now.
He needs to be smart. One of our fastest movers is going to be one of these two guys. Push it too much, incur a big penalty, you won't move on. Paul could go for it and try and win, or, well, we'll see. Paul staying low in ground effect as he heads into gate one. This is a very interesting challenge. Let's see what his speed is as he goes through the first gate, 147, one of our faster pilots. He, too, goes fairly straight into gate two, much like Hannes Ark. Very quick roll, very tight turn out of Paul. No chance of over-G because the airplane is not up to speed. As he comes back through three, I'm going to say he's going to be behind. And he is. Hannes Ark as he goes into the chicane. But here's where Paul excels. Minimal flight control input. A tighter line into five than the Ark. As he goes over the tree, he too is wide as he goes into six. But look at Paul. He's going to dive down. Wings level nicely. Nice turn here at Horseshoe Corner as he comes back into the course. Here's where Hannes had a little trouble. Into seven, Paul's clean. Now into the chicane. This is a little wide out of Bonhomme. Can he keep the speed up as he comes around into nine? We're still seeing red on the sector times. One more time here as he goes to gate number 10.
This is it. Hold on. Let's cheer for Paul Bonhomme. In and out of Champions Corner. It's not looking that good. Red light, no green. Four tenths off the pace. 230 miles per hour down the home straight. Has Bonhomme been beaten by Ark? Watch the clock. Oh, he's missed it.
55, Bonhomme.
Ark has beaten Paul Bonhomme, but Bonhomme will go through as the fastest loser. Bonhomme is still in the competition. He lives to fight another round. Oh, the two fastest times of the day. Hannes Ark wins this seventh and final heat in the round of 14, but Bonhomme still progresses alongside the Austrian.
All right, Paul did a nice job flying out there. I thought a little bit wide in places. Watch him here against Hannes Ark. Hannes much quicker out of gate number two, and that's what keeps him ahead. Even a tighter turn out of Ark could mean more speed, more G. But as they come back through here, gate three, and go to the chicane, you see the Bonhomme, Team Bonhomme airplane catching up, but not enough, all right? So these guys need to go back and find some speed. They're going to meet each other now in the round of eight. We're going to see the same matchup. format. Not, I'm sure, the one of the favorites for Paul, but they both got their work cut out for him here on the next round.
Do you ask yourself, with that tactical play by Paul Bonham, because Mike has just hit the nail right on the head. They will go up against each other again in the round of eight later this afternoon here at Ascot, England. But so far, so good for the British fans, with both Bonham and Nigel Lamb going through to the round of eight, where we will see head-to-head battles in the sky once again. Here is the lineup for the next round. Maroya against Bissegnier, Ivanov against Shonka, Nigel Lamb goes up against the Aussie Matt Hall, and Bonham goes up against Ark once again. We say goodbye to Goulian, Doldra, Velarde, Chambliss, McLeod and Francois Lavotte. That's all we've got time for. From Nick Fallows and Mike Mangold, many thanks for your company. We'll be back at 4 p.m. local time with that round of eight. Thanks for your company. Bye-bye for now. Hello and welcome to Ascot, Berkshire, in the heart of the English countryside for round five of the Red Bull Air Race World Championship 2015. The UK's leading thoroughbred horse race course hosts the world's fastest motorsport for the second successive year. And if 2015 is anything close to the event of 12 months ago, this weekend will be the most thrilling, closely fought and critical stop of the season so far, with Britain's air race fans expecting nothing more than a home pilot 1 and 2, which we also enjoyed a year ago. Well, joining myself, Nick Fallows, in the commentary box is former double world champion Mike Mangold from the United States of America. And Mike will be casting his eagle eye over proceedings throughout the day here. Now, let's take a look at the best of the action from the round of 14. A knockout stage, seven pilots go through and the fastest loser advances. And the first top story was Nigel Lamb versus Kirby Chambliss, Mike.
Nigel here just a little high in gate five, flying a little wider, uncharacteristically high. He gives Kirby an open door. Kirby flying second has the opportunity to advance, but Kirby having a green run till the very end here in gate 11. He's also high. He picks up a 2 second penalty and hence gives it back to Nigel.
So close, but not to be for Kirby. Nigel Lamb advances to the round of eight. This was one of the big shootouts. Heat six, Pete McLeod against Australia's Matt Hall, two of the fastest pilots
see
this
here,
season.
Pete down here on gate number six in the golf fairway. Something going on here. Just clips the right wing by 25 centimeters. Hits a pylon, 3 second penalty. Obviously, that's another open door for Matt Hall, who flies a near perfect run, but still room for improvement as Matt advances to the round of eight.
And due to the fact that Hannes Arc was slowest in qualifying and Paul Bonham was the fastest, the world number two goes up against the world number one in the final heat of this morning.
Hannes has a good run, a little shaky, but under review. This is close, but as he gets through the finish, no penalty. Again, a track record, Hannes Arc. Paul Bonham now sees what Hannes has done. He's got to make a decision how fast to push. Does he want to win? Does he just want to move through as the fastest loser? I think Paul gives it a gallant effort, very nice flying, and Paul's going to end up as the fastest loser. Still one of the fastest time in a round of 14.
For the first time this week, Paul Bonham is beaten out on the Ascot racetrack, but he still advances to the round of eight. Now, the irony of the situation is that Bonham will go up against Hannes Arc again in the penultimate round of today's competition. Lamb races Matt Hall, the second British pilot, Ivanov for France up against Martin Shonka, and Japan will go up against the Hungarian pilot, Peter Bissegnier. These are the pilots that are out of the competition. So the British fans still have plenty to cheer about, with both the British pilots who finished first and second last year in the round of eight. But there is no lucky loser or fastest loser in this part of the competition. Four winners will go through to the final flight of the day here to try and take round five of eight on the Red Bull Air Race World Championship for 2015. So there's a confirmation of the pairings once again. It's a straight knockout. No times carried forward to the final four round. And Japan and Hungary Yoshi Maruya and Peter Bessenier are the first to fly. Bessenier on track for a career best or a season's best here, but Yoshi Maruya will start as the favourite.
Yoshihide Maruya, Japan.
In 2015, we have a good progress and are now ready to be on the podium. So we're looking for the last four races.
And on paper, Yoshi Maruya has had the better results in the first half of the 2015 season. A sixth in the season opener in Abu Dhabi, eighth at his home race in Chiba, Japan. I think this is a very close, a very even match here as Yoshi Maruya, with this unique standing start,
smoke on,
takes into the track. Race director Steve Jones says, Yoshi Maruya, smoke on. And a real fire up from the cockpit from the Japanese pilots.
I think Yoshi's just coaching himself on. It's not for the G's. There were none there. Nice turn, a little higher than most out of gate number two. And now he's coming down to gate three, where he's getting up to race speed as they go into the chicane. This is a very simple entry the first time through. Really a nice, easy descending chicane. Gate number five, ever so critical. As you go over the trees into gate six, the pilots are blind. They must get the proper lineup, wings level, as he starts another high G turn back to the right and through gate number seven. Now, this second entry into the chicane is very critical. They have to go a little wider so they get a straight entry, not such a hard or late turn. He's doing it nicely as he comes through the chicane to gate number nine and one more high G turn.
That high G turn is called Champions Corner. Up and over goes Yoshi Maruya. Now he's looking to get as much speed as he possibly can. You can hear him pulling hard on the stick and really willing himself on in the cockpit of this Edge 540. Now here comes Maruya, looking to go below. 107 spot 623. Oh, look at that!
Almost Maruya, 1 minute quicker. 6.706 seconds, no penalties. Currently first place in heat eight.
A smile on the face from his team cockpit. Team captain Rob Fry, Yoshi Maruya, delighted. We see that from the onboard camera. This is by far the best Maruya has flown all week long.
Well, we're seeing some faster times already here in the round of eight. The weather conditions are ideal. The temperature's cool. There's no wind. So this is going to be an opportunity to improve your time. Yoshi set the standard for Bessenier to do. Very little mistakes in Yoshi's flying. Perhaps he could have flown a little bit tighter in some places, but Bessenier is going to have himself a real challenge.
Peter Bessenier, Hungary.
At the first half of the season, I was not competitive in my previous plane. But now with the new baby, I'm competitive again.
And let's take a close look at this new baby. Peter Bessenier with the cockpit cam on your screens. Of course, it's a brand new Edge 540 version 3, a wonderfully sleek aerodynamic cowling that makes this such an attractive plane. It's pretty fast as well. Now, Bessenier coming off the back of a sixth position in the last round of the Red Bull Air Race World Championship. You've got to go back a little further. He hasn't been on the podium since 2010. He hasn't won since 2007. But there is no question, Bessenier is getting back to his old winning ways.
You know, it's like a real rebuilding year for a team. Peter's trying to get back in the winning way. You say he's got a new aircraft. He's flown this before. Sounds like Peter's using the same technique. He's yelling, coaching himself on. His turn two, a little bit higher than most. Nice level line into the chicane. He has a very nice cadence. He's tighter than Yoshi as he goes into gate five. Now watch him over the trees. Does he go tight to six? No, Peter stays wide. You'll see him have a straight line here before six. Peter comes out with a little higher turn. You can hear that G-force is up to about eight or nine G's. Next turn here from seven into the chicane. Does he go wide? No, he's tight. He's nice and tight. Will he get late? No, he's in. He's a little bit late here. Handles it well through the chicane. Here's our important gate nine and the last of the high G turns. Over the tree a little wide here into gate number 10.
Now watch carefully because we're still to see a green light. Is there a little bit of extra speed as Bessenier for Hungary needs to find just over 8 tenths of a second to take the lead away from Yoshi Maruya? Will it be Japan or will it be the Hungarian? And it looks like it's a good day for Japan.
Number one, Bessenier, 1 minute 7.465 seconds, no penalties. Sadly, second place in your heat.
Well, you can't ask much better than that. Almost 1.5 seconds faster than his round of 14 time, but not good enough to beat Maroya.
Right, improvement in time. As we see the graphic here, you can see that Yoshi's airplane is much lower and already ahead, but watch Peter accelerate coming down the hill. But if we follow this through, you're going to see Yoshi pull ahead. You can see it here again. So perhaps that Yoshi Maroya team airplane a little faster than Team Bessonnier.
Great news for Yoshi Maroya. We see him with the cockpit cam there for the first time in the 2015 season, making the final four. France go up against the Czech Republic. Nikola Ivanov, the first man to take to the sky.
Nikola Ivanov, France.
So far the season, it's not so good for me. I've not done as well as I wanted. I hope that the next part of the season will be much better.
And he's hoping for a repeat of the 2014 season. And it all kick-started here last year, Mike, where he took third position, then went on to win in Dallas, USA, and in Spielberg at the season finale. So it seems to be that the overland courses favour Ivanov's elegant style, but he's really going to have to go some to put the heat on Martin Schonker here right now.
I think these overland courses needs a more technical pilot that can deal with all the adversities. Nicholas, one of the more experienced aerobatic pilots and air show pilot on the series. This is what he does full time, is fly airplanes, little airplanes like this. So he's a master at these things. Very good feel for the aircraft. As he goes through gate number one, this is where the timing starts. Watch his speed, 144 knots, about average. We've seen faster. And Nicholas here into gate number two, he's staying flatter than what we saw out of Bessonnier and Maroya. As he comes around to three, airplane's not going to accelerate as well, but he's got a little better line as he goes into the chicane. This is an easy chicane for the pilots this way, just a right, left, right turn. Here's where it has to come together. Could be tighter here into five. How he goes over the trees. Want to go more direct into six to shorten the distance. Very tight turn before. Quickly comes around a little bit late, starting to turn out of six. These are areas where he can lose time. As he comes back through seven, he's got a nice setup here into the chicane. You're going to see him pull hard. Now it's just right, left, right, and then into our gate number nine. Without any wind today, this one's real easy. Avoids the oak tree, down into gate 10, the last of the high G turns.
Well, Champions Corner is the final test here for Ivanov. He's been consistently over 300 kilometers per hour throughout the challenge. That's over 186 mph. It's a clean run, no penalties, error-free. Ivanov looking to improve at 107.697.
Not as fast, 1 minute 8.08 seconds, no penalties. Currently first place in heat 9.
So,
hold
Ivanov,
three, please call grid and pit.
Now leaves himself hoping that Schonker picks up a penalty or two.
Right, Nicholas Fine, a little bit cautious or wide. You see him, takes a little straight line after some of the gates. He needs to start his roll quicker if he wants to decrease his time. You give up a little bit or you hesitate just a tenth of a second out there, and it adds up, and that's what we just saw in Nicholas's run.
So that's Martin Schonker's team in their hangar waiting.
Martin Schonker, Czech Republic.
The season is quite okay for us, except the not very good beginning, but we want to get even higher.
Well, there's only one place he can go if he wants to get higher than his performances in the last two races of the Red Bull Air Race World Championship. He was third in Budapest last month. He was runner-up to Hannes Arc in Rovine. He believes now, Mike, that he can win one, and it wouldn't be a big surprise for the other 13 pilots on the tour to see Schonker climb to the top of the podium at the end of proceedings today.
Right, well, this is where it's going to all start in this round of eight here at Ascot. He's got to advance forward. Here it is, opportunity. Nicholas, not a great run. Martin, if he has a good run like he has in practice, should easily move forward. But easier said than done. It's all in the execution as we mark Martin accelerate within 600 meters to get to the fastest speed he can where the timing starts at our first air gate.
Mike Schonker, smoke on.
Target time for Martin Schonker, 1 minute spot 08.088 seconds. And he has flown under that time on three occasions here at Ascot this week.
Martin a little bit flatter. This looks like a little wider turn from gate number two, conserving the G or perhaps not having the G. He did have a stall problem earlier in training. As he goes into chicane now, I see more aggression. Nice straight line as he gets through this. He's tight into five, and now watch as he goes over the trees. How much distance? Oh, he goes left. Again, this is a longer path before gate six. This costs time. He's quick on the turn. tight G comes back around. Now you can see in the sector time, still red, still behind Ivanov. A little wide here out of the gate number seven. He rolls out, hesitates into the chicane. These things are adding up as he comes back around to gate number nine. He's got one last chance with his big turn.
Well, Mike, is Martin Csonka coasting? Does he think he's got this easily taken? But he's in trouble here. He's 1.21 seconds off the pace. Don't forget, Ivanov was third in this race last year. Here's the first big upset of the round of eight. Csonka for the Czech Republic is in trouble. He's under review. There could be a penalty, and he still missed it.
Number eight, Csonka, 1 minute 10.114 seconds. No penalties. Sadly, second place in heat nine. Hold three, please. Call grid. Nicholas just touching down.
There is no third back-to-back podium for Martin Csonka of the Czech Republic. Nikola Ivanov of France goes through in heat number nine in the round of eight.
His chicane is good, but it's these big turns in the setup. If you, you know, you can go wide to get an easier setup, but it's going to cost you. It's longer distance.
Well, that is a big surprise. Yoshimaruya going through in the first heat, putting Bechenier out of the competition. And Nikola Ivanov, the French pilot on your screens, has successfully put Martin Csonka, world rank number four at this point in the season, out in the round of eight. And for the first time this season, Ivanov is in the final four. Well, we still have two heats to go. Nigel Lamb of Great Britain will go up against Matt Hall. There's his son, Max Lamb, who's his race analyst. He will be studying those lines you can see on the computer there to try and give his father the optimum performance and the opportunity just to pinch the line a little to find a tenth of a second or two. And as you can see, the British fans are waiting in anticipation because both British pilots are coming up in heat 10 and 11. Let's go to the race airport where Jonathan Ledyard is talking to Yoshi Maruya.
Yoshi, time of 1 minute 6.706 seconds. You're through to the final four for the first time this season. What's going really well?
Actually, my team is working quite hard after Abu Dhabi, but it takes time to get here. But it's coming together now, so we're in good shape now.
I know you've got some new cooling ducts. How are they helping? Because that was one of the problems. The engine was overheating.
Yeah, actually, the engine was really hot last two races. So we are working very hard after the Budapest, and it works quite well. Yeah.
So Nikola Ivanov is through. There's some big guns still to come. How confident are you that having got through to the final four for the first time, it'll be a podium for the first time in 2015?
Yeah, of course. Yeah, it's final four, so it's a big chance. Then, but I have some space to go a little bit faster, so I think we can go through it.
On that warning, we'll let you carry on.
Yeah, it's good, yeah.
Great words from Yoshi Maruya. Basically, that means bring it on. I'm ready to have a dust-up with anybody as long as it's through those 25-metre-high air gates, Mike. But it's so good to see Yoshi Maruya finding self-confidence once again.
Right. Like you said, he's got his team coming together. It takes more than just the pilot, the airplane, his tactician. And I like what he said. He sees places where he can improve, and that is the key. If you see a problem, you can fix it. He sees areas where he can go faster. Give him time. They will be faster.
So the two British pilots are left to fly in this round of eight. Down on the Ascot steeplechase course that Nigel Lamb is preparing. We've just had a chat with Yoshi Maruya. Mike, I have to say, Yoshi Maruya has one of the sleekest, most beautifully looking aeroplanes of all out there.
Yoshi's is the first one with the streamlined turtle deck, so he's got less drag in the back part of the airplane. We essentially think of it pinching the air. Peter Bessonnier is another one that has a new version 3. He's got a new engine cowling. He's got some fancy wingtips. He, too, has a lower turtle deck and canopy. So we're seeing these airframe modifications because we have a standardized engine, a standardized propeller. You can't do much to the power plant, so the pilots are going to the wingtip, to the fuselage. The landing gear is next, and more in the tail feathers to come.
So two have gone through to the final four, and there are still two decisions or two heats to be contested here at Ascot. 40,000 spectators over the weekend have really enjoyed the Red Bull Air Race World Championship returning to Berkshire for the second time, and some spectacular views. The cricket pavilion, the soccer pitch, the golf club, all part of Ascot's heritage here. But it's that magnificent grandstand, the iconic grandstand here at Ascot, made so famous by the centrepiece of the sporting programme here, Royal Ascot, in June, that so many of us love to see and find recognisable.
Okay, coming up next is going to be our two MXRs racers. We saw this same matchup here last year between Lamb and Hall. These guys have almost identically the same aircraft, so it's going to be very hard. It's going to be a pilot's race to determine who moves on.
Heat 10. Nigel Lamb goes up against Matt Hall, the 2014 champion, up against one of the big stars of the 2015 season. Lamb has his work cut out here.
Nigel Lamb, Great Britain. My season so far has been riddled with inconsistency, not as good as last year, pretty disappointing, and hope we've managed to do enough in the last few weeks to get it right for Ascot.
Let's hope he has got it right here in Ascot. Turn the clock back 12 months. Nigel Lamb flew brilliantly to take second position. Vicky Griffiths and Max Lamb, Nigel Huxtable, Team Breitling waiting patiently in the hangar. But it's now down to their pilot.
Nigel Lamb, smoke on.
The 2014 Red Bull Air Race World Champion, Nigel Lamb, to do the business and book his spot in the final four.
Well, the technique on start seems to be go to the left to get a lineup through gate one into gate two. Most of the pilots are doing that now. This is a very good turn out of Nigel. First turn to come back to gate three. Tight turn, let the airplane accelerate. It looks like he's doing that now as he gets into the chicane. Just a nice, easy cadence. Here is where he had his problems last time. Too high in five. Look at him. He's definitely in the red zone. Over the trees now. More of a direct line to six is possible. Let's see how he comes out. He's a little high, but within the zone as he comes back from six to seven. A good shot over the trees by staying high. It helps his viz. And now from seven to the chicane. Oh, a little hesitance there. A nice, and he needs a good setup here to get through the chicane quickly. As he goes through gate nine, he's got to watch for this old oak tree. He clears that. Now it's into 10 for the last high G turn and a sprint to the finish. Again, Nigel electing to stay very flat, very hard turns.
Out of Champions Corner, into the penultimate gate. Now he tests the performance. Up to 350 kilometers per hour. Going for the line, looking to put the pressure on the Aussie. Error free, penalty free. Out of 106, 993.
1 minute 6.993 seconds, no penalties. Currently first place in Heat 10.
The 2014 champion digs deep in front of the home crowd. Oh, almost 3 seconds faster than any time all week long. Just when he needed, he's produced the goods, Mike.
You know what? I think it's his first turn there in gate two. At less than race speed, Nigel found a one tight turn there through our gate number two. And he came back around very tightly, was still able to get the airplane up to acceleration. He flew very nice chicanes. He stayed in the red zone, error-free, and I think one of his best time of the whole event so far.
Well, Britain enjoyed getting the better of Australia in the cricket and the Ashes series, and it could well be a repeat performance here at the Red Bull Air Race World Championship. Nigel Lamb really has thrown the gauntlet down to Matt Hall.
Matt Hall, Australia. First half of the season, 2015, it's been pretty good for us. Pretty happy with where we're positioned, 5 points off the pace, and let's roll the second half of the year and go for it.
You couldn't wish to meet a more personable pilot. Matt Hall really does do Australia proud. A former Royal Australian Air Force fighter pilot. Not too many years ago, he was still in active service, but he's loved his time at the Red Bull Air Race World Championship, and he's almost come of age this season, Mike. Three podiums from four races, but this is going to take some beating. He's got to fly sub 1 minute 07 to deny the 2014 champion, Nigel Lamb. As you predicted, Mike, this really is the battle of the MXSR.
Right, this is it right here, and these pilots are improving their times here as they end this round of eight. So if he follows suit, he should be faster than he was in this round of 14. two, also a very tight turn from gate two to gate three. As he comes through here, we'll see he's in the green a quarter of a second. Through the chicane effortlessly. He's conserving energy. Little wide, he's very wide actually, from the chicane into gate number six, rather five. And look back left and then right. These things are causing some time. Let's look at the split time. Still green, despite this wandering around in his flight path, if you will. As he comes into seven, over banks, rolls out. He's very tight now, coming back into the chicane. And now he just needs to keep it in the red zone, keep it error free as he goes through gate number nine for the last big turn. I think it's going to be green.
Oh, he's improving. He's getting faster and faster. You can see the ghost plane of Nigel Lamb just behind Matt Hall. It's live as it happens. Here comes the Australian, Matt Hall. The Breitling dream could be over as he carried the speed through. Goes for the finish line now, and Matt Hall puts Australia into the final.
Number 95, Hall, 1 minute 6.531 seconds, no penalties. You are the winner of Heat 10. Hold three, please. Call grid. Nigel just touching down.
Sorry, thanks, mate.
Well, as you look at Matt Hall, you can see he's rolling faster, stopping the airplane, much more aggression. He stepped up again to what he needs to do. It's still a very close race, just winning by 0.4 seconds. If the ghost was synced, you know, the replay was synced up properly, I actually saw Nigel's airplane in front of Matt, and he pulled forward at the end. But nonetheless, it is really the driver that did it this time, Matt Hall. Good job.
Well, good job for Matt Hall into the final. Eric Seisler is TC chatting to our race reporter there, Jonathan Ledyard. A great result for the Australian team. Thumbs up. They're ready to go and happily into the final four. Heat 11 is the last one of the round of eight. Once again, Bonham goes up against Hannes Arc. This time, Bonham goes first.
Paul Bonhomme, Great Britain.
Here we are at the halfway stage. We are 5 points ahead. If you'd asked me that at the beginning of the season, I'd have been very pleased, but it's going to be very hard work to stay here. But looking forward to it.
Well, the quintessential English gentleman, Paul Bonhomme, very calm, very cool, very calculated, and that describes his flying style as well as his personality. But Bonhomme needs to dig deep, deeper than he's had to all week long. Paul Bonhomme, who still owns the track record from qualifying at 1 minute 06.023, quite possibly needs to fly sub-106 to really turn the screws on Hannes Arc of Austria, who flies next. Bonhomme versus Arc, world rank number one, out on course.
Ball doing what all the other pilots are doing. Go right, come left, cut the angle here into two. Good turn out of Paul, not one of the tighter ones, but he's letting his aircraft accelerate. That's his strong point as he comes back through three. Very clean run. Airplane up to speed. A little hesitation there on his turn into the chicane. Now a little high as he goes to five, but a tight line as he goes over the trees. Paul's going to keep a wide, safe line. Dipping down into six. This is where we've seen problems. Nice level through the gate. Very flat turn from six back to seven. The visuals are tougher if you stay lower. But he's set up nicely from seven. Easy on the turn. When he sees a straight line through the chicane, he pulls it in tight. Very effortlessly here through the chicane and up to gate number nine.
This is the style that we love watching from Paul Bonhomme. Clean, error-free, and those smooth lines mean maximum efficiency, optimum speed. Now watch the clock carefully. He must be 106. We'd like to see him go below. Bonhomme now heads for home. Full throttle, full speed. 104, 105, 106. Oh, it is under review, but
106.5. 6.542 seconds.
No penalty. Penalty free.
In heat 11.
Bonhomme, a little shake and nod of the head. From his team coordinator, Nigel Warren. Is that good enough to beat this man on your screens, Hannes Arc?
There is going to be a sad story here. Hannes Arc, unable to get his aircraft started, cannot answer the start call.
Oh, I can't believe this. There's the technician, Nigel Dickinson. It's actually Nikola Ivanov's technician now, Jim Reed. He's trying to get the plane going. Here we go. This is his last chance. The clock's ticking here. He's going to run out of time. Oh, look at Nigel Dickinson. The technician for Hannes Arc's look of disbelief.
You can see they've got an external battery plugged in, so he's got more power to the starter, but we're not hearing the spark plug fire. We're not hearing that combustion sound. The engine is literally not firing. You can turn it all you want, but unless you can get that spark plug to fire the fuel-air mixture, it will not continue to run.
Well, Mike, we must point out to many of our viewers, this happened to him in qualifying. You think that it sorted that out overnight? Tell me more.
One of the things here with this series is there's very little time to make major modifications or changes to your aircraft. I mean, these airplanes just turned around from the round of 14. You can't rebuild the engine. You can't rebuild a carburetor like in drag racing. You've got to just make some small adjustment. So they're trying everything they can. Hannes is doing all the little tricks that he knows. I would say he's got about 2 more minutes to answer the call, and they're going to do not start him.
Well, the race jury are watching. They're all looking at their clocks because he is going to run out of time here unless it fires up pretty soon. Hannes Arc will forfeit the round of eight by default. He cannot get the engine started. Head judges in the center of the three there. There is the race director, ultimate decision, down to Steve Jones, himself a former air race pilot. Just about everybody with knowledge is there helping, even Nikola Ivanov's race technician. Yeah, Jim Reed is trying to help. One more time, one more chance. Oh, this is a nightmare for Hannes Arc. The Austrian fans cannot believe it. Now it's not looking good at all.
You see the power. They got to get the power plug back in. There's no power to turn the starter. The battery only, you know, gives you so many opportunities. So, yes, disappointment mechanically. Not much Hannes the driver can do. He's doing all he can, but he's going to need some luck here. Ultimately, we have to look back on the buildup on this. There was probably some early indications that there was some engine trouble. And without having time to diagnose and look further, this is the unfortunate result for Team R.
Well, sadly, this is not the way we like scores to be settled. All of the pilots like to get up into the sky in the racetrack and may the fastest man win. But by default, by a technical issue, is a huge disappointment. And the UBFS team will be heartbroken if this plane, this engine, doesn't fire up in the next minute or so. The time is clearly against Hannes Arc, and it's not going to happen. We'll wait for the race director, Steve Jones, to call it. And the decision is now with Steve. And I see on my computer screen in front of the commentary box monitors here that it's a did not start, which means Paul Bonham, not the way he wanted to, I can assure you, has gone through to the final four with Matt Hall, Nikola Ivanov and Yoshi Maruya. Oh, spare a thought for Hannes Arc, sitting in there trying everything. And he just doesn't want to go. And that's it. It's over for Hannes Arc. The helmet is off. Nigel Dickinson cannot believe it. His technician, the man who's won the last two races of the Red Bull Air Race World Championship to claw his way into second spot in the championship standings. Let's not forget, he'd already beaten Bonhomme in the round of 14. Confidence at an all-time high. And the engine won't start. A technical issue puts Hannes Arc out of the competition as Bonhomme comes back into land.
Right. Well, we've all been there. We've had our automobiles at home, at work, wherever, that won't start. These are technical problems, sometimes unforeseen, not much you can do, but you have to answer the race call here. You know, we can't hold it forever, and Team Arc is going to need to look at this aircraft, you know, find out what's wrong. They'll get it started. They'll get it out of here.
So, let's take a look at the pilots that have qualified for the final four. Yoshi Maruya is in the chase for Japan. Let's not forget that he's not made a final four all season long. Nikola Ivanov, watch the Frenchman carefully. Remember, third here 12 months ago. Matt Hall, who is battling it out with Bonhomme in qualifying, looking for his fourth podium in the fifth race of eight this season. And Paul Bonhomme looking to repeat his success of a year ago here in Ascot, take his third win of the 2015 season and extend his lead in the World Championship standings for 2015. There is Hannes Arc on your screens looking at the other planes in disbelief here. But we can confirm Hannes Arc is out of the competition. Bonhomme goes through and races against Matt Hall, Ivanov, and Yoshi Maruya. Keep waving, keep waving, keep waving. Well, the British fans still have reason to cheer. Yoshi Maruyama has already made his way back out onto the jumps course here at Ascot. But look at this. There's our race reporter, Jonathan Ledyard, just giving Hanisock a few moments to gather his thoughts before the interview begins. We'll get to Hannes as soon as we can, but, well, you can guess his answers to the questions as quick as I can. He's going to be bitterly disappointed. Jonathan, it's over to you.
Hannes, what happened?
Yeah, what happened? I don't know. Engine doesn't start, and I don't know. Engine doesn't start. If the engine doesn't start, I can't race.
I understand. And the same thing yesterday. So did you get to the bottom of that problem?
Yeah, we thought that we got on the bottom of that problem, but it looks like there's still a problem. So I don't know. I'm a pilot, so I have to ask with my technical team, and then we'll see.
How frustrating is that? I know that's a silly question on one hand, but I mean, you were setting a sensational time, track record in round of 14.
Yeah, it's frustrating if you don't get a chance to race. Very simple. We're here for racing, and, well, it's life.
OK, then, thank you.
Well, many thanks to Hannes Ark there. There are many a sportsman that would have just turned away from the television cameras, but he's showing us how bitterly disappointed. Mike, you've been in similar situations in your race career right. In years gone by. This is the worst way to go out of a competition.
Oh, it's just terrible. And as a driver, you feel helpless because you're in the hands of your mechanic, of your team. You kind of trust them. That's why you picked them. That's why you did this, so that they prepare the aircraft properly. Hannes is correct. As the driver, you get in, you drive it, you execute the plan. I mean, Nigel Dickinson here, they need to look at what went wrong with that engine or what is wrong with the engine. And, you know, unfortunately, I always said the pilot wears three hats. He's the pilot, he's a team manager, and he's the owner. It's a lot going on. Hannes, as a driver, is doing what he's got to do is focus. But as a team owner and manager, you got to look at your people, your equipment, and it's got to be ready to race.
And the biggest story is that technical problem for Hannes Ock may well have a dramatic outcome in the World Championship standings, because he will finish in fifth position, or maybe even in eighth position, when his eighth position is a real nightmare. Just one championship point. And here's Bonham potentially on the verge of taking 12. And Matt Hall, who Hannes Ock pushed down into third, will move back up into runner-up position if it all goes the Aussies' way. Mike, stay with me. Don't go away. Let's get right back down to the race airport, where Jonathan Ledyard is going to grab a quick interview before the final with Matt Hall.
So, Matt, final four, no Hannes Ark, up against Maruyama, Ivanov and Paul Bonham. What's the thought?
It doesn't really matter who I'm against. I'm just going to do my best, and you know, I'm flying fast enough to win. These guys are too, so we'll just give it our best shot.
Oh, well, that's a confident pilot if you ever heard from one.
Well, that's all business. That's the way you got to be. You can't really even think. Even Jonathan asked a little bit of a different question, but Matt is focused. He's going to go out there, like he just said, and go fast, because any one of these pilots could win this race. So watch what Matt Hall does here.
Mike, you're a 2-time world champion. You were the best for many, many years. I want you to put your money where your mouth is. Who are you going to tip for 12 world championship points and the win here in Ascot?
Oh, yeah, I don't like to pick against my compatriots or comrades out there, but I must say, Matt Hall looking very strong with Team Hall out here. I want to point out with the Hannes Ark problem, it's not just one man, it's a team. This is a team effort, and it's motorsport. In motorsport, we see the drivers a lot, but we got to understand that it's the equipment, it's the preparation, it's the whole team product that gets you to the podium.
Four left in the last round. Heat 12, Maruyama of Japan, Ivanov of France, Hall for Australia, and Paul Bonham looking for the repeat of a year ago and bring Britain the win here at Ascot, Berkshire, England. Are you ready for this? We are just about to start the last flight of the day. We're at the final four round, from 14 to 8 to 4. Japan, France, Australia, Great Britain. Maruyama gets the action underway. Ivanov flies second. Matt Hall still looking for his first win, third, and Bonham lost. Yoshi Maruyama is the first man up. Now, This is the first time he's been in the final in the 2015 season. Does he shoot for the result or does he push it right to the wire, Mike, and go for the win? No. Because we know Maroya has a fast plane and we know he can make up a second or two.
Boy, there's no second guessing. You got to go for it here. Yoshi's got an opportunity to win a race. You got to go all out, because if you don't, these other guys are going to get in front of you. As Yoshi goes through gate number one, a little straighter line, a little descent into two, this is to gain speed. Very quick with the wing slaps, but that's what you have to do to pick up time. He's a little higher than the other pilots as he accelerates down the hill into gate three. We'll see a quick wings level right into the turn as he's coaching and you know, encouraging himself to turn quicker. As he comes around here to five, this is a tight line, rolls out a little bit. Let's see if he goes tight to six. He stays wide as he drops down here into the fairway, just in there in gate six. You've got to make sure you're in the red zone. A very tight turn as he comes back to seven. You're seeing a nice setup here out of seven. This is a moderately wide turn into the chicane, giving up a few tenths of a second. Nice case. There's your penalty.
Incorrect
gate
level.
Six.
Gate right. Six, you called it, Mike. And that puts pay to Yoshi Maroya's chances of a win here, but maybe still could grab a podium. I have to say, Mike, the light conditions, the storm clouds are gathering very quickly above us here.
Yoshi did what he had to do, which is push it. He took a chance, one small penalty. Let's see how the other guys do as Yoshi sprints to the finish.
And he pays the price. Absolute commitment from Yoshi Maroya. 109 spot 426 for the Japanese pilot. Here's gate six where he got it wrong.
Really not quite wings level. He makes the effort to roll out level, but he doesn't get within that 10 degrees of the level plane. And of course, they pick that up with their cameras and you're going to incur that penalty. But again, this is what I say. You have to be that quick, that aggressive.
So Nikola Ivanov is up next. Remember, the times start afresh. So the target is 109.426 for Ivanov. He's flown as fast as 107.967. Don't forget that this is one of Ivanov's lucky stops on the tour. He was third here last year, and he could well pull it off for a second time of asking. All he needs to do is maintain the pace that he has been showing us all day long and keep it penalty-free, Mike.
Exactly. We know Nicholas. Nicholas can be hot or cold. If it's good, it's going to be a great run. And on the other side, he can really tube it if he has some errors. He accelerates here. He's going to go left, come back right for this lineup from gate one to two. It helps cut the angle as they make that hard turn.
Mike, quick word on the visuals. The clouds are gathering. It's looking a lot darker out there than it was earlier today.
Right, so the light is flatter. There's less precision. Oh, a stall. Uncharacteristic. Nicholas too hard at too slow of an airspeed. That cost him some time. He's got a little opportunity with the penalty out of Yoshi. But as he goes through this chicane, he's picked it back up. He's back in control. Nice line, a little wide actually here into gate five. Over the trees, down in the fairway for six. Let's see how he does here. We need to be wings level, he is. And now, very tight turn, no stall here. He has more speed. Obviously in the green on Yoshi, because Yoshi has the penalty. But Nicholas, a little too wide, I think, here out of seven into the chicane as he comes back around. Now this number nine, watch his lineup with the big oak tree. Is the tree gonna affect him? Yes, he has to climb up and go down. And here again is where he stalled. First time through, much more speed as he comes to the finish.
In the final for the second time this season, comfortably ahead of Yoshi Maroya, but it's always under review here. There could be problems for the French pilot, Nikola Ivanov. The jury are not 100% happy with this performance. 2 seconds of penalty. It came on gate seven, flying too high. It's not good enough either. It's slower than Maroya. Ivanov has gone second after that 2 seconds of penalty. Well, can you believe it? Yoshi Maroya is guaranteed a place on the podium. Right, only the second podium in his career. Mike, this is where he went wrong.
A little bit too high there as he comes out of gate number seven into the chicane for the second time. They're worried about getting the proper setup here, but you can't get too far ahead of the airplane that you don't fly the proper zone through the gate. And so maybe thinking too far ahead, not getting his altitude under control, and this is where we have the problem.
Well, Yoshi Maroya has earned only his second podium in his career to date, no matter what the outcome of the remaining two pilots. Well, the first of the duo will be Australia's Matt Tahall. How many times have we talked about England v the Aussies or the Aussies getting better of the English? And it's another one of those classic sporting duels. Matt Hall going up against Paul Bonham. Paul Bonham beat Matt Hall in qualifying, but can Matt Hall find a little bit extra? He's flown as fast as 1:06.284, but today his fastest is 1:06.531. The atmosphere is electric, because for me, this race will either go to Australia or it will go to the home crowd, Paul Bonham and Great Britain. The Australian waiting calm, patiently for the all clear to take to the sky with this unique standing start.
Let me point out, there's been two runs, two penalties so far. Could that follow suit with Matt Hall and Paul Bonham? I doubt it. However, Matt, if he's thinking, has a dilemma here. Push it, win the race, fly comfortably, be second place. I think he's going to go all out.
He's never won a Red Bull Air Race World Championship in his career to date. Fair to say, he's been knocking on the door all season long. Second in Abu Dhabi, second in Chiba, third in Ravine, slipped a little in Budapest to go fifth. He's corrected that here in Ascot. And I have to say, Mike, this is a brilliant start from Matt Hall.
Very tight turn from two into three in the green, obviously, on the other penalty-ridden pilots. Through the chicane, minimal effort. Yeah, moderately wide here as he comes into gate five. Oh, a bank to the left. He's not sure of his line. Over the trees, down in the fairway. This looks tight. Wings level, up from gate number six. Good view for seven. Now watch as he comes out of seven to the chicane. A tight turn is faster. A tight turn can get you in trouble. This is a good tight turn. Can he get through the chicane without getting behind? A little behind, but he handles it well. A hesitation there as he goes through gate nine. Ooh, nice over the oak tree. Too much of a correction. Too much down. These are costly tenths of a second. And a big tight turn around at gate 11 for the finish.
Wow, was he within the rules there in Champions Corner? It's under review. He got the wings a little late to be level through gate 10. And here comes Matt Hall. A 2-second penalty for Matt Hall. Incorrect level through gate 10. Oh, still good enough to go into top position. But surely now this is Bonham's for the taking. And again, he was getting later and later in the racing line until the error came in that 10th gate, Mike.
Well, you know, we're seeing penalties at everybody as we see on the replay here. As he comes into 10, again, these airplanes roll so quick, the pilot gets ahead of the airplane, and they get past the 10 degrees of bank angle, and boom, there's the penalty. Matt flying a good aggressive run, a little wide at times, but when you get behind and you feel the need to get aggressive, you've got to pass your helmet with the wings level through the gate. Let's hope Paul can get through without a penalty.
I think he can here, Mike. Our apologies. We've just got a slight technical issue with regards to our feed to the race tower and the comments of our race director, Steve Jones. Rest assured, we're working on that, but let's stay with the action here. Matt Hall is in top position. Yoshi Maruya lies second. Ivanov of France is third. There is one pilot left to fly. The current world championship leader. 17 wins, 42 podiums, and the winner here last year, looking to give the British crowd what they've watched and waited all day for. Can Bonham, with so many of the fans in the crowd already with their hearts in their mouths, deliver? It must be penalty free. It must be faster than 1:09.024. Over 20,000 people applauding on their feet. But he's got to fly 12 gates. He's got to fly 12 gates out of an average speed of 200 miles per hour. There is Team Bonham. Wade Hammond on the left of the screen, the technician, some say the most important member of that team. Here comes Bonham. Here comes Bonham, looking to bring a British success at Royal Ascot.
Paul decides to stay in ground effect and pop up high, get a good lineup here. 1:46 is a good speed through gate number one. Nice and straight. Now he lays the turn. Nice, tight, but not overly tight turn. I think Paul's flying smart here. Going to be error-free as he comes back through gate number three. Will it be green or red? It's green.
So, green by a nice margin, Mike. 1.95 seconds, the right side of the clock. It's looking perfect so far for Bonham.
Very smart run by Paul. I think he knows exactly where he's at and what he needs to do. And the big key, like you said, is error-free. Every one of the other three pilots before him has got a penalty. Paul's just flying textbook here. I mean, clean. It's not the tight. It's a wide turn. This is a wide turn. But it's fair. It's clean. He's still fast.
Here he comes, Mike. This is the tricky gate. This was where Matt Hall had problems. He's into gate 10. No worries for Bonham. Just bobs over the oak tree. Now he's in champion's corner. And he's looking like the champion in champion's corner. Into the penultimate gate. Gets those wings level. Here comes Bonham. Come on, Bonham. This could be his third win of the season. His second in Ascot. And it is there.
Number 55, Bonham, 1:06.416 seconds.
Paul
congratulations,
Bonham is the king
you are the winner of the Rebel Aero's Ascot 2015.
What a brilliant performance, absorbing all of the pressure.
Thank you, everybody. That is not what I call a relaxing day at the office, but I am going to have a beer.
Very well done. Nicely done. Matt just touching down.
Well, he summed it up himself, didn't he? Not the most relaxing day at the office. So much pressure. Friends, family, sponsors, and, of course, us as the media expect so much from Bonham. But you have to say, this is why he's a two-time world champion, and he's well on his way to a third championship title, absorbing that pressure and performing when it's needed.
Especially now. But textbook, the way to do it is clean. It wasn't the tightest. Actually, it was one of his fastest runs, but no real pressure. Paul just knew he had to fly smooth, and he did. This is a smart pilot. He's got a good team behind him, and I don't think there's any stopping this team Bonham. They've got momentum now for this 2015 season.
Very impressive work from Paul Bonham. Now drawing 8 points clear of Matt Hall in the championship standings here at Ascot in front of a massive British crowd. 40,000 spectators over the weekend. Paul Bonham has recorded his 18th career win here. And it couldn't have happened at a better time, I have to say. All kinds of controversy 24 hours ago. But the final result sees Paul Bonham take the 12 championship points and the win here at Ascot in round 5 of 8 of the Air Race World Championship. Matt Hall, the runner-up. Yoshi Maroya, his best result of the season. And Ivanov finishing in 4th position. Well, Matt Hall lands back at the airport, but let's catch up with Jonathan Ledyard once again, who's chatting with Yoshi Maroya, his first podium of 2015.
Yoshi, congratulations. Your first podium of 2015, let's get that right. How happy is that? I mean, that's a vindication of all the hard work you've done so far this season.
Yeah, we are so happy about the podium. We are working quite hard after Abu Dhabi, get a new plane and the team get together and the new tactics. So everything is coming get together now, so we are, you know, ready for the podium, all the races. But I need to be used to on a final four.
You are on the podium, but actually you're on the third step. You could possibly have been on the top step, couldn't you? You had it in your plane and yourself, but for that mistake, you could have been, you know, a lot closer.
Yeah, I think I'm quite pushing too much from the final four, so I'm not getting used to. So I'm now learning the final four, so I'm good for from the next race.
Anyway, well done.
Yep, thank you.
Well, let's hope this is the start of more things to come from Yoshi Maroya. I have to agree, most impressive work on his plane, and now the pilot finds the confidence, and all of a sudden it all gels together. Well, Matt Hall will be delighted to have taken his 4th podium result of the season. 2nd position again. Surely, Mike, his victory is around the corner. He's got to win one at some point in the proceedings.
Right, they need to keep stepping up their game on that team Hall. Certainly had the opportunity, but the penalty in the final four, you just can't do that against Paul Bonham. Interesting to note, everybody's doing all these modifications, and old team Bonham, they got the same wingtips, pretty much the same thing. There are some tricks under that cowling that Wade Hammond's doing, but on the outside, it looks like the same old team Bonham aircraft. So are these mods helping?
So here's the confirmation of the points that have been earned today. Bonham adds 12 to his championship tally. Matt Hall takes 9. Maroya finishing 3rd, 7. Ivanov, 5. Nigel Lamb, 4 points, finishing in 5th position. Bessenier, 6th. And McLeod, 7th. Then we see Hannes Arc after that nightmare with the engine failure, only collecting 1 championship point and no points below 8th position. Championship standings, Paul Bonhomme draws 8 points clear ahead of Matt Hall, who goes from third to second position. He too is eight ahead of Hannes Arc, with Shonka and Nigel Lamb making up the top five in the championship standings after five rounds. Still no points for Valade and Francois Levant. Let's get back down to the race airport and have a chat with the pilot flying into second position, Australia's Matt Hall.
Matt, so close so far, but you closed into second place in the World Championship, which in the long game, that's important.
I decided that this race, if I got to the final four, it's time to start trying to win. Yeah, the first half of the year, I've always been saying it's gathering points. Now, I've got, if I want to be the world champion, I've got to start winning. So I took a bit more risk on that last run. There's a little bit in it, but Paul beat me fair and square, so even without the penalty. So well done to him.
Oh, what a beautiful shot. What a great picture. And, of course, an ecstatic Paul Bonhomme. Really feeling the pressure throughout the week here at Ascot. But the best thing for Bonhomme is to let his flying skills do the talking. And that tactical play has worked to perfection today, Mike.
There are a lot of pressure Paul's felt, you know, outside the cockpit with the format, the rules, what we can do to the airplanes. You know, and Paul bears a lot of that as one of the front runners out here. And he's a spokesman for the pilots. But you're right. Once you get in that airplane, close the cockpit, it's all business. You get to do what I say is self-expression, what we like best, which is go fast.
Well, here is Jonathan Ledyard with the man of the moment and the winner here in Ascot, the current 2015 Red Bull Aries World Championship leader, Paul Bonhomme.
Paul has asked for Matt Hall's time, but I'm just going to say congratulations. Never mind Matt Hall's time. He was second. You've won.
Yes, very pleased. Hard day at the office. Still not a big fan of the format, but, you know, today was great fun. I actually enjoyed it.
But what a crowd, what a reception, what a feeling. You're now 8 points clear in the championship, three rounds to go. Job well done at home.
Yeah, and all I can say is teamwork. You know, teamwork, teamwork, teamwork. I'm only the driver. I just sit there and point it in the right direction. Without the guys, you know, Wade, Powell and Nige, everybody else that's involved, there's hundreds of other people involved. They know who they are. It's just without their help, this wouldn't be possible.
The way you celebrated, and you might say, yes, it was a bit of a show for the crowd, a bit of acting. The point is, that meant a lot, didn't it? To win here in Ascot with so much history, your dad a big race goer as well?
Yeah, he'd be even more chuffed now that he's bred two winners at Ascot. Chuffed a bit.
Well done.
Thank you. Thanks.
And, of course, not only Paul's father, but his wife, Laura, his young daughters, Olivia, Florence and Poppy, and his son, Charlie, they're all there watching Dad do the business. But you know what it's like, Mike, also adding to the pressure just a little bit.
Oh, yeah, the home race is your worst race. So many distractions. You've got to manage that. And, again, like he said, you have to have a team manage that. You get your assistants and people like that to keep everybody happy on your team. And it all comes together here when Paul gets to focus on his job. Now,
Mike, just like the jockeys, they have to weigh in after the race.
Exactly. We want to make sure that the race weight is consistent. We're trying to make everything as fair as possible here with the standardized engine. We have a standardized weight or a minimum weight that all aircraft must bear. If they come in underneath that, we're going to find out that they jettisoned something out there. So we're trying to make it as fair as we can so that it's more of a driver test. Still, the airframe is the thing that's getting modified out here.
Let's just take a quick look, Mike, together at this shot. Look at the adoration. The fans, they're absolutely delighted. Again, a sensational crowd of 40,000 plus over the weekend here at Ascot. They've put on another great show, this iconic grandstand, and now, of course, this great presentation prize-giving area. Everything gets shaped like a horseshoe. I wonder if they'll start changing some of those shapes of the flowers and start making them shaped like an aeroplane, because it's been a tremendous weekend here in Ascot, and, of course, it always helps when the home hero does the business. Paul Bonhomme, I have to say, seemed to be feeling that pressure yesterday. He got a little frustrated with the format of the competition, but he's kept his calm, absorbed the pressure, and had a spectacular result here. Repeated what he did 12 months ago.
The feeling we all get is these are serious race fans here. This is horse racing at its finest, and now we're bringing air racing at its finest here. They appreciate what's going on out here. They like to see these professional pilots and the whole team and the whole crew where we do the setup here. So I think very fitting that we come to such a prestigious horse racetrack with our prestigious air race event.
And of course, the series is far from over, as Jonathan and Paul Bonham, today's winner, were chatting down in the grandstand there. We still have three races to go, and Spielberg will be the next stop on the Red Bull Air Race World Championship on the 5th and 6th of September. And then we're off to the United States of America to wrap up the season. We'll be in Fort Worth and Dallas on the 26th and 27th of September, and a real bright lights finale in Las Vegas, USA, on the 17th and 18th of October. But what I'm trying to get to, Mike, is you're kind of setting this man up as the guy to take his third world championship after today's 12-point score.
Boy, it's looking real strong. Great lead in the point series. Now they just got to follow through. They actually got a little cushion where they can give a bit if they have to.
So here is the presentation ceremony. I think this is the best way to watch any ceremony, from the helicopter up in the sky. Congratulations to Paul Bonham. Let me give you a few facts and figures. Paul's 18th win of his career to date, 43 podiums, retains that title as the most successful air race pilot. Matt Hall, well, he's going from strength to strength. Matt Hall, he's now had 9 podiums, but he said it himself in his interview, desperate for his first win. And Yoshi Maruyama takes his second podium of his career, as we all stand for the British national anthem. It's the result that we all wanted. Paul Bonham has repeated his success here in Ascot from a year ago and has emphatically won round 5 of the Red Bull Air Race World Championship in front of a delighted home crowd. Congratulations to Bonham, who draws 8 points clear in the chase for the 2015 World Championship. That's 8 points clear of Matt Hall, with Hannes Arc in third position. Congratulations, Bonham, our winner here in Ascot today. Well, Sir Christopher Harper, the Director General of the NATO International Military Staff, presenting the awards to our pilots. That's a lovely wide grin on the face of Yoshi Maruyama there. He said it himself in his interviews. Hard work from all of the team paying off. And we've said it on a number of occasions throughout these live programs, Mike. The pilots drive or fly the planes, but you've got to have a good team behind you.
Yep, and even these pilots are acknowledging that fact. So a team effort. But these guys are the ones that are the pros that are driving it, and you can't cross the finish line without a good driver.
And the traditional champagne celebration. It's been a dramatic couple of days. It all started off with the inclement weather on Thursday and Friday, when we just sat around for 48 hours and we didn't even take to the sky. That added to the pressure for Saturday's qualifying. Not a lot of track time coming into race day. But the most experienced pilot and the most successful pilot of them all has claimed the championship points and the victory here in Ascot today. So as we said, Bonham maintains his lead in the 2015 World Championship standings, but the season is not over. We still have 3 very exciting stops to go. And the first of that trio, Spielberg in Austria, an incredibly exciting Formula One track and a very fast and exciting air race track. Game day, the 6th of September. Please make sure you join us there. It will be yet another thrilling competition. That brings us to the end of our live broadcast from Ascot in England. From Nick Fellows and former world champion Mike Mangold, many thanks for your company. It's goodbye for now.
Perfect news already, oh. Gonna give me a reason not to feel so cold. Something special kept right up my sleeve. Gonna give you a reason not to go and leave.
Congratulations, you are the winner of the Rebel Airways Ascot 2015.